Well, that's how they present themselves. Can you, well, it's obvious, quite a lot of it, but can you just shortly tell us what you want to show by this video?
Yeah, our slogan is Al Arabiya, know more. So people increase their knowledge when they watch Al Arabiya. And in this ad, which is about 40 seconds, we want to tell people that we live the story, we are part of the story, we are unbiased, but yet we are in the heart of the story, telling people the story from inside rather than monitoring or checking other sources.
Okay, that's the picture they want to paint of themselves. I thought we should start with Syria, this terrible war there, going into its third year now. And we, as Western journalists, of course, work with Syria as well, but it would be interesting for us to hear how you cover the war there. And then I thought, do you get visas from Damascus to go in there?
Of course not. It's a hopeless case to apply for a visa from Damascus. We already have an office in Damascus, and our people are not allowed, our staff in Damascus are not allowed even to go take camera and film how is the weather there in Damascus, let alone filming what's going on in terms of big events. We smuggle our correspondent to Syria from time to time. We have a permanent correspondent in northern Syria at this time. This correspondent was only a local person who had interest in media. We gave him some training, as well as other local journalists. We equipped him, and now he's sending some good stories. From time to time, we send senior correspondents to troubled places in Syria. They spend 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks there, and they come back with some good stories. But I have to say, it is one of the most difficult places on earth to cover. Syria has never been a friendly place for media. It was always a hostile place for media. Foreign media was not allowed to operate freely there. If you operate in Syria, then you have to tell the good news about Syria, not the bad news, the bad news about Syria. Our challenge now, number one, is security challenge. How can we make sure that we are sending our correspondent there and then get them back safely? Yeah,
can you make sure?
It is very difficult, and it's a very delicate operation. We, in one incident, one of our cameramen lost his foot in one incident, and the reported had some slight injuries. It is extremely difficult. Many times we send our people halfway inside the Syrian territories, and then we call them back because it's not very safe. Safety of our journalists is very important, as you may know as a journalist. The second issue is, how can we balance the story from there? Because when you send people, the only place we can send people to now is the places controlled by the opposition. We are not allowed to operate inside the places which are controlled still by the regime. How can we balance the story? This is another challenge.
Yeah, there has been criticism that you're too sort of biased towards the opposition.
I can understand these accusations that we might not be covering the other side of the story as much as we wish to cover it, because we are denied access. We are denied access. We applied many times to go to send our senior correspondents to Damascus and to the government-controlled places. We were denied access. As I said to you, our office there, our crews there are not allowed to film anything outside their four walls. And also we applied for so many interviews with President Bashar al-Assad and with his assistants, with his government, with no avail. So I think the Syrian regime succeeded in positioning us in a way that we are not covering his side of the story, of course, because they are not allowing us to cover their side of the story. However, we count on some researchers, independent researchers inside the Syrian regime areas. we count on some other sources as well, and we take some footage from Syrian television and some social media which are related in a way or in another to the Syrian regime in order to balance the story.
What is your experience with these people that you equip? I mean, ordinary people who are not journalists, but who are inside there, you equip them with cameras and things and enabling them to send stories back. What is your experience with them?
It's a very difficult experience because our standard is different than the standard they are used to. They are citizen journalists in most of the cases. They have some ambitions to be journalists and they have some interest to carry on what's going on in their places to the rest of the world. But they did not have, they don't have, they are not trained to be journalists. They don't know what sort of equipment they need to do. They don't know how to protect themselves in troubled areas. And they don't know how to deliver the stories, their pictures, their video and audio to us in our headquarters. The main thing we provide them with is their safety requirement, like helmets and bulletproof jackets. We provide them with a camera. We provide them with a communication tool, and mainly it is normally satellite communication tool. Satellite phone communication tool, where in worst case scenario, they will still contact us, keep contacting us, and they will keep sending data over this satellite communication tool, which is also smuggled to this part of the world. And we give them over the phone training, because unfortunately it's not possible to get to them or to bring them to our place.
But it is a difficult place to report from. I mean, you as well, as we do take footage that has been uploaded to some website, and we don't really know. We always have to warn our viewers that, you know, this is just uploaded from a website. We can't sort of guarantee that this is the truth in a way. And I suppose you have the same problem.
This is an extremely important point, because now, some people send pictures over. We are desperate to get any kind of content from Syria because there is a huge amount of events going on there and there is little coming to us from there. So we are desperate. We have the thirst to get material from Syria. And we monitor all the websites. We monitor all the social media platforms. And we fell into the trap a couple of times because there is something which belonged to the Syrian regime called Syrian Electronic Army. The Syrian Electronic Army's job is to mislead the media, to create some fake things, send it to the media in order to mislead the media and discredit the media. This is number one, and make the media's job more difficult. And the number two is to hack some website. Our website, our Al Arabiya Net website was hacked many times by the Syrian Electronic Army. Now, what we do, we have a dedicated office to deal with Syria, dedicated desk, I mean, to deal with Syria, with highly expert people, highly experienced people, and these people check every single video, every single piece of information. They cross-check it with other sources, and until we are sure 100% that this video is genuine, then we air it. If we are not 100% that this video is genuine, we don't air it. And that's why we miss lots of stories, because we were not 100% sure that it is right. And that's why sometimes people blame us. Why did not you report this? This is a true story. Because our credibility is really very important for us, like your channel, like any other channel on earth. But as I'm saying, it is extremely difficult now to cover a war like the Syrian war without professional journalists on the ground. You know, you are a foreign correspondent, you cover places outside, and you know what's the difference between being an experienced journalist covering the place, covering certain place, and being a normal citizen who's never been to a media school, who's never worked in media organization, who just has the passion to work in the media.
Before we go to the Arab Spring and how that has changed, or maybe not changed, yeah, changed, I think, reporting in the Middle East, I just have to ask you, as you're a Lebanese, you're a man from the area, and Syria, it seems like endlessly going on. We're into the third year now. How do you think it could end?
Well, unfortunately, I cannot see any end for Syria. I think the whole area is changing dramatically, big time. And I see this, the conflict in Syria, a deep sectarian conflict between Sunnis and Shia. And this sectarian conflict is an extension, or it has been extended outside Syria. So it is, you have the super regional powers. It is Iran, which is Shia, and Turkey, which is Sunni. And you have some other Sunni powers in the area, like Saudi Arabia, and some Sunni countries which are rich, like Qatar, for example, who are helping the opposition in Syria. And you have some Shia powers in the area, which are extension for Iran, of Iran, like Maliki's government in Iraq, and like Hezbollah in Lebanon. They are extension of the Iranian politics and the Iranian strategy, and they are fighting with the regime in Syria. And I can only see that this war in Syria is spreading instead of being contained, instead of being managed, instead of being solved. I'm afraid that we have signs that it is extending to Lebanon, it is extending to Iraq, and I personally have lots of fears that it might get extended to Turkey. You know, Turkey is a country where you have around 14, 15 million Alawites. And in Ankara now we have an Islamic government. You know, Turkey was, as we know, Turkey was traditionally a secular country. Now the secularism in Turkey is diminishing for the sake of the Islamic government. And the Alawites and other minorities in Turkey, I believe they will not be happy. And the Alawite-Sunni conflict in Syria will have a chance to spread to Turkey, unfortunately.
Very pessimistic.
Well, I'm sorry.
Okay, we'll still go on talking about covering the Arab Spring, and we'll show a clip from Al Arabiya again. It's in Arabic, but it will set the tone.
عمل إرهابي لا يمكن السقوط عنه.
وسترد كيد الكائدين وشماتة الشامتين.
مجموعة قليلة مريضة
بلطجية مستأجرين.
الآن سقطت الأقنعة عن وجوه هذه الأطراف.
حزني وألمي كبيران.
إلى مواجهات مؤسفة.
الشبان ليس لهم ذنب أبدا، هم صغار السن.
لا تقطع طريق، لا تقتل النفس المحرمة.
أدمت قلبي كما أدمت قلب كل سوري.
لا رئاسة بدل الحياة.
المحققة للانتقال السلمي للسلطة.
أنا لو عندي منصب، لو عندي لوني رئيس، لو كنت لوحت الاستقالة على وجوهكم.
أنا أرفض السلطة وسأرفضها في الأيام القادمة.
فأنا أكون في هذا الموقع بدعم من الشعب، وعندما أترك هذا الموقع يكون أيضا برغبة من هذا الشعب. هذا الموضوع محسوم مهما سمعتم.
أفندم أنا موجود.
فأنا في سياساتي الخارجية في كل المواقف استندت إلى الدعم الشعبي وإلى البوصلة الشعبية.
الشعب يريد إقامة الشعب.
أنا سأذهب إلى أمريكا.
What did he say there in the end after Assad's laughter?
Well, he said that was the Yemen president saying, I'm going to America. Unfortunately, American denied him a visa. He was not able to go there. I have to say that before the Arab Spring, if you allow me to comment on this, before the Arab Spring, it was not common at all to mock presidents of the Arab world. It was understood across the media that you can criticize so many things, but don't touch the presidents. The good thing about the Arab Springs is that you can now touch the president. You can criticize the president. You can mock the president if they are not doing a good job. And I don't know if you follow Egyptian media at the time being. There is the best rated program in Egypt now. It is a political cynical program. It is conducted by someone called Bassem Youssef, who became a big star. He's the John Stewart of Egypt. And this guy's job is to mock the president all the time. And unfortunately, this president, the existing president, Mohamed Morsi, he played the game and he wanted to put this guy on trial, which made this guy mock him even more.
So some people have managed the transition, obviously, from a very controlling regime with censorship and all that. But what about the news media? How have they coped with, in countries where there has been a strong censorship, where you haven't been allowed to do a lot? How have they coped? Are there good media emerging out of this?
Yeah, as you know, changes always create problems and they create opportunities as well. And we had big changes in the Arab world when it comes to freedom of speech. So we used to have only local media before the 90s. We used to have only strictly controlled government media. So, and the television in each country should start their bulletin every day by how the president celebrated dinner with someone of his family members. You should start with the president, whether he does something good or bad. He always did something good, apparently then. Okay, and then we had the pan-Arab satellite media, which broke the rules. And in terms of regulation and technology, regulators in the Arab world did not give license for terrestrial channels. So terrestrial channels, except in Lebanon, was always owned by the governments. The satellite technology allowed us to break this taboo, to break this monopoly. And we managed to create pan-Arab media across the Arab world. But this pan-Arab media, in order to succeed, we had to unify our audience to focus on some stories. So we focused always on some generic stories, for example, Iraq or terrorism or Arab-Israeli conflict. Okay, so all the Arab world were listening to the pan-Arab media, but we were not allowed to operate locally as we should. And it is not in our commercial interest to operate locally, because if you talk about local issues in Yemen, for example, the people in other country won't be interested. After the Arab revolutions, this taboo has been broken, and the local media has its chance to mushroom. And
now, does that mean that you have bigger competition now?
We have. Our biggest competition now is from local media. And it is a big dilemma for us, to be honest. It's a big dilemma because now we found ourselves, we used to have to compete with Al Jazeera, and it's easy. We beat Al Jazeera in a couple of years, and now we became the number one news channel in the Arab world in a couple of years. But now how can we sustain the audience which we have in Egypt, for example? The top 10 channels in Egypt are Egyptian channels.
NBC, because many people do prefer local media.
Because many people are interested in local media. So the mood of audience in the Arab world is shifting. and there will be gradually we will lose the pan-Arab audience, and gradually the Israeli-Arab conflict will not be a pan-Arab story. Gradually, Iraq war will not be a pan-Arab story, and gradually, Syria war will not be a pan-Arab story, because people have their own local issues. People, they did not bother about elections. Now they have parties, and they compete, and they do their campaigns, and this is a big story in each country. They were not allowed to talk about jobs. Now people are allowed to talk about jobs. They were not allowed to criticize the government. Now they over-criticize their governments. So it is a big challenge. It is an extreme challenge for us. However, there is a vacuum in the local market when it comes to experience, the know-how, how to do professional use in the local
market. Yeah, that was what I thought, the transition from a sort of state-controlled media to...
I think it's, at the time being, it is still chaotic, because we have much higher level of freedom of speech, but do we have more professional news offering in this part of the world? I doubt it. I think it is still long way before we do this. And the only way we can reach this point is by, number one, regulate it in a nice and fair way, and number two, which can be number one because it's equally important or more important, is to enforce somehow or encourage the commercial aspect of the news industry. So now the news industry in local Arab countries, and except of Al-Arabiya, unfortunately, all the news industry in the Arab world are subsidized by political money, okay? And because they are subsidized by political money, their job is not just to tell the news. Their job is also to carry propaganda, which makes no difference than before revolution, okay? Now I think it's a must to encourage commercial concept in the news industry.
But you're talking about now that people are reporting other things in the local media. Well, you mentioned Egypt. I don't know the other countries. But the new governments in these countries, how do they deal with a new sort of media picture?
Well, the new governments, unfortunately, they are amateurs in governing. Unfortunately, in most of Arab post-Arab revolution countries, And they are in many cases they are thirsty of power, and they want to be dictators, and they want to lock the media. Like, for example, in Egypt, the government banned one of the channels. The government is still not giving proper licenses for channels because they want to make sure that they can legally block these channels when they want. The government is still putting journalists on trial. The good thing about it is the government can no longer get away with these issues.
How has internet sites such as Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube playing such a big role in the Arab Spring? How have they changed the media landscape?
Big time, I have to say. It's a big time, and it is another competition for us to have. We discussed this internally, and how are we going to deal with Facebook and Twitter? Is it going? And the best way is for us. The best way is to ride them and to be part of the game instead of dealing with them as a competition. In some part of the Arab world, people. And I'm talking about, for example, in Saudi Arabia, because people cannot go out and say publicly what they think. The only way to communicate and to tell other people what they think or what they know is through Twitter and sometimes through Facebook. You know, in Tunisia, the revolution started by a picture which was posted on Facebook and then communicated through Twitter and social media. And you know, in Egypt, the first thing after the revolution, when the revolution started, the government stopped the internet. And in Syria 2 days ago, the government stopped the internet because they believe that this is the best communication tool for lobbying and for campaigning. In Saudi Arabia, you have the highest rate of using Twitter. They use Twitter to criticize government because they don't have local media which criticizes the government. In Qatar, it's the same case. They use to ask for jobs, to campaign for anything, to tell people how bad was the management of the latest flooding in Saudi Arabia, which the government was not used to cope with. And even they can go in some cases even further. In one of the cases, a Saudi young man who's in his early 20s tweeted on the prophet's birthday. He tweeted what he thinks of that prophet, and he said to the prophet, there are something about you which I admire, and there are something about you which I dislike. Okay, and he stated what he admires and he stated what he disliked, and that was blasphemy in Saudi Arabia. This is not allowed at all. So this guy has to fly to Indonesia in order to protect himself from a legal case. Unfortunately, the Indonesian government handed him back to Saudi Arabia, and he was put on trial again, on trial in Saudi Arabia, and he was sentenced to death. But at the same time, you find lots of Twitter activists who are defending him. And so far, the authorities in Saudi Arabia did not execute him because there is a big debate about the matter encouraged by Twitter, by social media use. In Al Arabiya, we are using the social media big time. We have around 305 million likers on Facebook and more than 8.5 million followers on Twitter accounts.
When you look back at it now, what has happened until now in the Arab Spring, how do you think that the Arab media has managed to report on it?
Well, I have to say that in most cases, unfortunately, the Arab media was part of the conflict. I remember in the beginning of the Arab Spring, or so-called Arab Spring, our competitor Al Jazeera used to claim credit for encouraging this. And then when we saw lots of blood in the streets of Libya, in the streets of Syria, and sometimes Yemen and other places, then they stopped claiming credit for this, okay? And the media, I think it is still not mature enough. There are challenges on the media all over the world because of technology and the changing market. And these challenges do exist in the Arab world, but they are much more now because of the revolution and because of the political funding of the news industry. So unfortunately, the news industry in the Arab world, it's still at large extent funded politically. And the only solution, the only way is to commercialize, to create this commercial concept. So if you can live commercially, then you can survive. If you cannot live commercially, then you are funded politically, and political funding of the media must not be allowed.
As you said before. But what do you think about the Western coverage then of the uprising in the Arab world? How did we do?
Well, I think the Western coverage from the beginning of the Arab Springs was massive coverage. I really admire it, and I have to say that the Western agencies were one of our sources of news. And I have to say I admired my colleagues who from the West who went to Egypt. For example, one of the ladies were raped in Egypt during when she was doing her job. So people made sacrifices. Mary Calvin of Britain, who you may know, was killed in Homs. Anthony Steed, who was the correspondent of New York Times in Syria, also passed away on his way back to Turkey because of his asthma. So people really made big sacrifices. Western journalists made big sacrifices in order to cope with the to cover the story. And I have to say, I understand that they are doing their best to cover both sides of the story, but I have to say also that the focus is more on the opposition, because this is the more accessible part of the story.
There is in Norway and in this part of the world there is Islamophobia, and do you think that's growing, or how do you look upon that?
Well, I believe Islamophobia is overrated big time. And to be honest, as an Arab person who lived in the West and lived in the Arab world, sometimes I have to look for Islamophobia to find it. I know our job in the media is to look for the negative things and focus on them. But to be honest, I found it really overrated. The number of mosques in Europe is still growing. The Muslim community is living peacefully in most of the cases. Okay, you find sometimes people talking about the burqa, that this is sort of Islamophobia. But it does exist in Egypt now, because we have a government of Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, and the liberal people in Egypt think that the Muslim Brotherhood is going to Islamize the country. So they criticize every conservative Muslim act imposed by the government. And they put the government also in a defensive position, that the Minister of Tourism said, we did not ban alcohol. What does it mean? He's saying that we are not Islamizing the country. So does it mean that there is Islamophobia also in Egypt? I think this is overrated for a big extent.
Before we let the people here ask you, I want to ask you about ownership, because you said commercial media, that's the way forward, not politically owned. Your own channel is owned by the Saudi Arabian royals, mainly. That ownership, what does that mean? Do they put any restrictions on you, or?
Well, I have to correct.
I mean,
you.
Saudi Arabia is a country that isn't really democratic.
Yeah, let me clarify this. Our company is privately owned by a businessman who's not part of the royal family of Saudi Arabia. Our company, MBC Group, Al Arabiya, is part of MBC Group, and MBC Group is the largest media group in the Middle East, and it is the only profitable media organization in the Arab world. The only profitable. MBC makes lots of money every year. And Al Arabiya unfortunately loses money, and NBC cover our money. And I feel that it is not fair competition for me to compete with people who are funded by government, televisions who are funded by governments or by political parties, because they have different calculations when they spend their money. They have different calculations. So that's why,
But do the ownership give you free hands?
Definitely, definitely. We have some consideration, but they are commercial consideration. So for example, if 70% of our revenues come from this country, from one country, then we have limitation. This one country has some commercial influence in Al Arabiya. And that's why freeing the market won't make us subject to having 70% of our revenues coming from one country. We don't want to have 70% of our revenues coming from one country.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's see if there. Yeah, there's one there. If anyone wants to.
Hi, I'm Øystein Bogen from broadcaster TV2 here in Norway, and I also have a question regarding ownership. And you know, I would like to ask that question, the last question, a little bit more concrete. There have been a number of controversies with fired editors and journalists at Al Arabiya, and I'm just wondering, what are the concrete no-go areas for your channel being Saudi-owned? Can it, for instance, talk about the Saudi opposition? About the possibility of an Arab uprising there?
Okay.
Yep.
Well, I'm not really aware of the first part of the question. If I understand it right, did you say that some editors were fired?
According to sources, yeah.
No, this is not true. I can tell you for sure this is not true, and you can quote me for this. Absolutely not true. This is for the first part of the question. The second part of the question, I tell you that no other media organization covers Saudi Arabia the way we cover Saudi Arabia. We cover the poverty in Saudi Arabia. We cover the bad management of the government in Saudi Arabia. We cover the lack distribution of wealth in Saudi Arabia. No other media organization which I know of covers Saudi Arabia the same way we do cover Saudi Arabia. At the same time, do we have restrictions in our Saudi Arabian coverage? Yes, we do have restriction in Saudi Arabian coverage. We are not happy about this, but unfortunately, 70% of our revenues come from there. Commercial revenues come from there. And this can be stopped at any time. We have to survive. If you choose between being funded, fully funded by a government, or funded commercially and somehow influenced by the government through commercial channels, what do you choose? Unfortunately, we don't have a perfect situation. We chose the least damaging situation for us.
But what are your restrictions?
Our restrictions in Saudi Arabia? Well, for example, we don't mock the royal family in Saudi Arabia.
So the show you were talking about in Egypt, there couldn't be a John, Saudi Arabian John Stewart.
Well, maybe on social media.
Okay, any more questions? Yeah, come on.
Well, I would. You sounded really pessimistic about the whole area.
Mm-hmm.
Would you have a dream scenario for instance, Egypt now?
Well, I'm really pessimistic also about Egypt. I'm sorry, I'm pessimistic. I wish I'm not. But when it comes to Egypt, I think Egypt was important in the last century, in the 19th century and 20th century because of Suez Canal. And Suez Canal was important to the Western power because it was the short way to go to colonized Indian subcontinent. Okay, after World War II and after India got its independence and France and Britain were no longer superpowers in the region, Egypt lost this statue as strategic point. But Egypt was always the biggest country in Africa and the biggest country in the Arab world and the most open country thanks to Suez Canal business, which Suez Canal created lots of business around Egypt. Unfortunately, since Nasser till now, the infrastructure in Egypt did not get any better. The education in Egypt is very bad. The illiteracy rate reaches 40%, and in some cases in rural area, more than 50% in rural areas in Egypt. And the Nile River is shrinking, and Delta and Nile River is shrinking. The Ethiopians are now building dam on Nile River, which is going to affect the water stream to Egypt, and the explosion of the demographic explosion of people let people build houses on the delta where they are supposed to grow their agriculture there. So the wealth is diminishing big time. The population is growing big time. And there's the human skills are not getting any better. So to be honest, and so we have corruption. We don't have good management. We don't have educated people, and we don't have natural resources. What do you expect?
On that very pessimistic tone, the time is up. But Nakhli, thank you very much for coming here and sharing your thoughts with us.
Thank you very much. Thanks.